You're assuming that the people are going to know that.
I want to mention something else now, but I have nothing to back it up. Because, well, let's see where it goes.
It's a podcast. You don't have to back anything up.
This is Delta Delta 1400 Security.
You are listening to Ground Radio.
One of my favorite movies based on a book was Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And during one scene, there are two aliens and two humans sitting in a spaceship.
I'm not familiar with this.
The quote is, "We can talk about normality until the cows come home." The first alien says, "What is normal?"
Right.
The next human says, "What is home?" And the final alien says, "What are cows?"
They're not even going to get that idiom at all, but yeah, what are cows?
The problem is, they're trying to have a conversation and they don't have a standard basis of reference.
Yeah.
Measurements are very similar. Without a basis of measurement reference, there's no way that we could advance as a society.
Having consistent measurements is something that we take for granted because we use them every day and we just assume that this is the way the world works. But there was a time before any of these standardizations existed with measurement, and it was chaos. As a species, we realized that if we wanted to build big things and if we wanted to be able to trade worldwide, which again, we take for granted these days, we were going to have to come up with something very accurate and very consistent quickly.
Yeah, absolutely. How would you feel if a nurse just kind of guesstimated how much of a medicine to give you? Or whenever you went to the gas pump, you were pretty sure you got the same amount that you did last time? Pretty rough going.
Yeah. How are you going to make a building with bricks if you can't make them all exactly the same size?
One story, you're fine. Two stories starts getting a little questionable. Other than that, I mean, you're talking to a civilization that they clout the Leaning Tower of Pisa as a monument, but
yes,
the thing is broken.
Italy's embarrassment.
Yeah, way to go.
Yeah. I don't know if you're familiar with the language in the story of Noah's Ark, but if you read in the Bible about the ark that Noah built, it says that the boat was a certain number of cubits by a certain number of cubits.
Okay.
As like old-timey language. And back then, a cubit was defined from the elbow to the tip of your middle finger. So, you know, if you wanted to go buy some lengths of hemp rope or something and you wanted to get a good deal, I guess you'd want to bring your big shack-sized friend with you to...
Yeah. Here's my long-armed friend who could touch his knees without bending over.
Yeah.
I think I have the advantage here.
Yeah.
I like the benefit of having your measuring tool with you at all times. That's pretty nice.
Yeah. Yeah. I bet you that guy had a big thumb, too. And you might ask yourself, when I said that measurements are crucial to having any large construction, you might say, well, how did they build the pyramids? Ah, there we go. Conspiracy time. But we do have a record that they actually carved out granite cubit sticks based on the current pharaoh of the time. And they passed those out to the foreman or whoever was, in charge of the measuring. I'm sure that they had to be, kept safe. And that is the only way that they would have been able to build these pyramids with such precision is that they actually did bother. That's 5,000 years ago. They understood the importance of consistent measurements.
And the U.S. even said in 1901, it's time to make a Bureau of Standards, which is now known as the National Institute of Standards and Technology. So they're dealing with more than just a pharaoh's forearm.
Yeah.
But there is a correlation between superpowers and being able to have standardized units. The idea of behind the standardization is so we can kind of pull our heads out of our butts and actually make something that we can consistently expect the results.
Yes. Now, when you were in grade school, did you learn the metric system after you had already learned feet and inches?
I don't even think I learned the metric system.
Really?
I didn't go to a communistic school. We basically stuck with the imperial system. It was inches and feet. That's all we cared about.
Okay. I specifically remember learning it. Now, in my generation, the metric system was looked at as something respectable, something important for science, something that the U.S. is behind and needs to get on board. But when my mom was in grade school in the 70s, the country was concerned that this was us conforming to the rest of the world and communism, the Cold War and all that was going on. So teachers were like teaching it under protest when they were forced by the curriculum to teach the metric system, that some of them were crying about it and feeling like this is a mistake.
Well, in the 70s, they had the big push for it to be into the United States. And I saw the biggest opponent to it were the unions. The labor unions in specific, they did not want the metric system because they thought that it would be easier for companies to be able to outsource, which is true. It would have been. The issue is now 45 years later, they are under the metric system. You actually have more of a problem because you have more confusion between the two of them. I have put together units in standard measurement that have components in metric systems. It's a huge pain in the rear end, and there's no reason why we stick with the standard system besides the fact that there are transition costs and there is a little bit of stubbornness behind it as well.
Yeah. Yeah. And from what I understand, the transition costs, which would be hefty, would pale in comparison within a few years of the amount of money we spend converting the measurements from one system to the other and the amount of mistakes that are made that cost millions of dollars. They have to make up for losses, and then they have to double label everything in the U.S., and it's very costly just to do that.
How much of it's already transitioned, though? How many times are you seeing anything that doesn't have milliliter somewhere on it? Like you said, they're already double stamped, but science, medicine, they all do the metric system. Even good old American Kentucky bourbon.
That comes in milliliters?
It comes in milliliters.
Yeah. Wow, they caved.
Well, whatever your booze tells you to convert, you just kind of listen.
Yeah, I think it's a great size.
I don't know. I miss saying a fifth, though. I mean, a fifth kind of has a ring to it. I mean, not to offend anyone, but I don't think sounding Canadian is a really cool way of thinking how much bourbon are you going to drink. How many milliliters of bourbon did you pound last night? No, that doesn't work.
I also think of beer being served as a pint. And when they bottle them at 333 milliliters. And it's a little bit less, like if you do the conversion. And I'm like, ah, these metric beers cost the same, but they are giving you a little bit less.
That's the transition cost that I'm concerned about. If I'm getting less beer, we are going to have some problems. And I can see that being a big opponent to the stance against the system. On the other end of the table, you have, you know, the benefits of being able to globalize, deal with other countries, have one set of tools.
Yeah.
I don't know. A little bit less beer, though, is a problem.
I saw a lot of complaints about modern day mechanics saying how frustrating it is to have to pay for, maintain, and keep track of two sets of tools, and how people all over the world just can't understand why they're watching this mechanic on YouTube complaining about conversion when they're like, that's not a factor for me. So just get with the program, basically. And getting back to it, I remember learning it in school. This was one of the only times I can remember ever stumping my teacher. He's explaining how the foot comes from the king's foot and the inch comes from the king's thumb and the yard. What was the yard?
If King Henry I stretched out his arm, it was the distance between his nose and his middle finger.
So yeah. So they standardize all these measurements based on this particular king's body, King Henry I. And I asked him, where does the meter come from? And he didn't know. He didn't know the answer to that question. And thanks to us deciding to do a little research on measurements, I actually understand why the meter is the length it is.
I think the best measurement for me would be the unit of circumference. Like something could be half of a Z and it just would be around my stomach.
Oh.
If I were king, I would want my stomach measured and used as a unit of measurement.
Okay. What is this, a baby shower?
It's riding high today. Or how far my hairline is receding back from my nose, I guess, would be a pretty good one.
All the things that you're self-conscious about.
Or how terrible my voice is. Is that a thing?
No.
Oh, well, there's that.
The people of France were dealing with a melting pot situation And so they were the most motivated to try to come up with some kind of standardization. And instead of using body parts and arm spans and
arbitrary measurements, yes,
they decided to go with something constant, the circumference of the Earth. And they were able to measure. There was a team. They started in Barcelona and measured north for a few hundred miles, and they were able to use trigonometry to figure out the entire circumference of the Earth. And then they divided that, and you get the meter stick. And that's the answer to that question. What is the meter? It's the Earth's circumference divided.
They measured the distance between the North Pole and the equator, and they divided it into 10 million meters.
But they didn't measure all of that. It makes it sound like they made a long journey from the top of the Earth to the middle of the Earth, and they didn't. They only measured a few hundred miles of it.
They measured a distance from Barcelona to Dunkirk. Where is Dunkirk, first off? I don't know.
It's the top of France, I believe.
Okay. And that would be obviously north.
Yeah, it was a direct line shooting towards the North Pole.
Okay.
But obviously water was getting in the way.
And using that, they found out the distance between the equator and the North Pole.
Yeah, it went right through Paris, so they used most of France. And I don't know what tool they used, and that's what I'm curious about, is if they had just 2 meter sticks, and they put one down, and then he put one down after it. And
next man up, next man up.
Yeah, I don't know exactly how they did it. But what is impressive to me is that if you take their measurements and their math and you actually measure the Earth with modern technology, they were only off by about a football field for the Earth's circumference.
Yep.
So it's obviously a superior system because it's more of a constant. Before they used the king, the inch was based on seeds and barleycorns. 4 poppy seeds was equal to 1 barley corn, and 3 barley corns was equal to 1 inch. And again, these things are going to vary in size and shape depending on what part of the world you are. So people were getting screwed left and right trying to figure out if they were getting swindled while they were trading in their new lands and how they define measurements.
Well, the one benefit of the metric system was that the meter is the base unit of measurement for distance. You can manipulate the size by a power of 10 based on the prefix you use. So centimeter, millimeter, or, you know, go the opposite direction, kilometer.
And expand it, yeah.
And there, you'll always have that meter as your base.
Yeah.
The problem with the imperial units is that 12 inches equal a foot, 3 feet are in a yard, and 1,760 yards are in a mile. It does not scale in the way that the metric system does, which is why it's used for science. You can talk about things expanding by the power of 10 a lot easier, and it's easier to wrap your head around it instead of having to do a conversion inside of your own system.
Yeah. And there are 2 imperial measurements between the yard and the mile that we just don't use. There's the chain and the furlong, and those don't use good math either. I believe the chain is 11 yards, and then the furlong is another absurd number of chains. And so either way, they don't fix it. It's like, this road is 1 mile and 5 furlongs, 4 chains, 6 yards, and you'd have to say each one, and it would be the only accurate way to measure it. So we just skip over those 2.
There's just so much absurdity stacked upon absurdity.
And that's where the acre comes from, by the way. The furlong and the chain make up the area of an acre if you line them up. And that was supposed to be how much area an ox could plow in a day. Yeah. Oh,
I love America.
Yeah. So thank God for the king and his foot. There is a foot somewhere cemented into the side of a building in Great Britain somewhere. And at a certain temperature, that foot is exactly 1 foot, and that's what we're still using, a physical object. For the sake of accuracy, the metric system has been completely taken off the physical. They're trying to measure everything and calibrate everything based on atoms.
Well, they have They have the power of reference, okay? So measurement, length, one thing, build off of that. As of the difference being that the imperial system used 7 or 8 different unrelated things And then we tried to fit those into each other.
Yeah.
But the metric system, as far as using atoms, that's like a retcon. That's kind of a situation where, okay, we know how far a meter is. How can we scientifically standardize that meter?
Yes.
And we use the speed of light to do that.
It's the distance that light travels through a vacuum in 3.33 nanoseconds. And then the third alien said, what's a second?
Very true. That's also a random piece of arbitrary measurement that we use.
Well, that's why I said the atoms, because you can measure that until the cows come home, until you figure out how long a second is.
Hold on.
The second is measured by the oscillations of the cesium atom. And so, therefore, we are using atoms for the basis of all measurement.
No. We are taking the unit that already exists, and then we are putting it against an atom, which has a consistent reference point.
Okay.
What we did was we took the basis, and then we found a way to consistently test it without any variations, and that's what our new basis is.
But
so the second was obviously designed before we were measuring cesium atoms, is what I'm getting at.
Mm-hmm. Well, the second used to be a fraction of the year. Just you take all the hours and minutes and how many seconds are in a year based on that, and then you have your second.
And then once the scientific community got a hold of time, they thought, well, this needs to be standardized in a way that we can measure consistently. Yeah. So that's when they pulled out the cesium-133 atom and watched its oscillations. The key to that one is that it doesn't vary.
Right. The Earth doesn't go around the sun the exact same time every year. Even that's a little bit off every year. And they do have to add leap seconds. It's not something that affects people in their daily lives, but they do have to change the clocks a little bit just to make up for it sometimes.
Yes. The time of the day is based on the rotation of the Earth. The month is based off of the lunar cycles. And the year is based off of the revolutions around the sun. None of those things are actually linked together in any sort of coherent system.
Right.
But we have found a way to make it as consistent as possible with a few rules, such as leap years, and then every 100 years you don't do a leap year and such like that. And as far as humanity goes, that's actually kind of impressive. So from a standpoint of humans working with what we have to work with, we did pretty well with time.
Yeah. Don't they use quartz crystals to tell time? Isn't that what, like, when your watch says quartz or your clock says quartz on it? Doesn't that mean there's a quartz inside that's timing the seconds?
The quartz inside is to maintain a consistent frequency to keep the mechanics running at the exact same pace.
That's interesting. I wonder if quartz is just that special, or if they are just manipulating quartz for time. Like, is quartz actually like, hey, it actually is exactly what a second should be when they...
No, they trim down the quartz to get it down to have the frequency that they want it to be in.
Okay. Oh, I'm glad you knew how that works. I love it.
Yep.
So you think it would be very easy for you personally to adjust if the U.S. just decided to up and go metric? You know, I mean, obviously there's going to be some different road signs, or, you know, a few things will have to change.
All I'd have to do is use the little numbers on my speedometer, which, I mean, is a major inconvenience for me. But I don't particularly have any love for the standard system. I don't think that standing by our imperial system does anything but hold us back.
The other nice thing about the metric system when they first developed it that I appreciate is that the volume, distance, and mass all correlate with each other. So you take 1 milliliter of water at a certain temperature, and you can fill up a 1 centimeter cube, and it will weigh exactly 1 gram. And I thought that was nice and clean, that they were able to take water, something that everybody can acquire, and get all the measurements to be related to each other, so that you could calibrate your own equipment almost independent of everything else if you wanted to.
All right.
There are people that will say that the nice thing about 12s, now I know that the imperial system isn't perfectly based on 12s, but the nice thing about having 12s is nice clean fractions without repeatings. And I think that's why 12 became such a holy number in the old days. If you have 12 of something, you can divide it evenly between 2, 3, 4, and 6 people, perfectly evenly. And with 10, you don't have that same luxury. And especially 3. With base 10, you have a repeating, an infinite repeating decimal for 0.33333 for a third. And so there are people that will argue that it's nice to have something base 12. And our time is base 12. And we've all adjusted to that. We have 60 minutes that divides evenly. We have 24 hours that divides evenly into thirds and fourths. And it's nice for shifts. It's nice to have everything happen on the hour. We don't have to have any fractions to divide the day. And so I'm not saying that the imperial system is superior by any means. I know that we're late to the game and we need to make a move. But at the same time, there's a reason why people stick with 12.
You can't cut a pizza into 10.
That would ruin the party.
Yeah. What is this? I'm leaving.
Right.
So what would your systems be? Would you be a metric system base 10 for time?
I struggled with trying to wrap my head around a system that would give us that. Okay, if we have a 10-hour day, then that means that each half hour would in actuality be about an hour.
This was actually proposed, right?
For a time in France, it was in use, and then it was abandoned. During this whole metric craze in the 17th, or maybe the 18th century.
Yes, you would use the kilosecond and the millisecond.
Mm-hmm. But then if you have shift work, for example, everyone's got to stop working on a half hour or a 45, or not a 45 minute. See, I'm so used to time. And that's what I'm getting back to is our minds can adjust. Like, just because we have 10 fingers doesn't mean we need to be a slave to the number 10. We did choose the number 10, and it's nice to be able to move the decimal a place for this or that. But in all actuality, when do you ever have to measure how many centimeters we are to the sun? It doesn't matter. You just use the appropriate one. We can live with not using base 10. People think that base 10 is the be-all, end-all, but I'm not so sure.
The decimal time is a clock that starts at the bottom, I would say. It's 0, and it goes clockwise to 9. It is a 10 decimal hours. Each hour is 100 decimal minutes, and each minute is 100 decimal seconds.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay, so currently we have 86,000 seconds in a day or something like that. What you're proposing, we'd have 100,000. So instead of counting 1 Mississippi, 2 Mississippi, we'd be counting a little bit faster. 1 Nebraska, 2 Nebraska, 3 Nebraska, 4 Nebraska. And that would get us through the exact amount of time that it takes for the Earth to rotate once on its axis.
I'm open to the metric system, but I'm cool with ignoring decimal time.
Everyone is.
Seems like a super big problem.
The world has adopted this time, and there's no exceptions there as far as I know.
You know what? All right, we'll do a compromise. We will switch to the metric system, and we will get rid of daylight savings time. How about that? Okay. That's all we're doing. Everyone hates daylight savings time, correct?
No.
Good. We can move on.
No. No. There's too much sun in the morning.
Ow.
So what do you think about the United States use of Fahrenheit for temperature as opposed to Celsius? Do you like Celsius? I think that all these Europeans and Canadians are feeling a little snooty on their high horse about having moved over to a metric temperature scale as well. What do you think of it?
Well, I would say that if I'm for the metric system, I think we would go with the Celsius as well. We'd go with a centigrade scale.
Yeah, I'm not sure I like it better. I don't know if you have a particular reason why you like it better, but I'm sure that in science, it's beneficial. But in everyday life, what do you use temperature more for? The weather?
Yeah.
Or boiling water?
The weather.
I just turn on my stove to 5, and then I wait for the water to boil. I don't care if it's 100 degrees. Like, I don't care if it's exactly 100 degrees. But for the weather, I think that 0 to 100 is a great scale. Like, if you're outside and it's below 0 degrees Fahrenheit, it's dangerously cold. You don't really need to be outside, or if you do, you need to have, like, special prep. If it's above 100 degrees Fahrenheit, that's dangerously hot. You really need to be in shade. You need to have special equipment to live in that kind of environment. So I think that Fahrenheit is nice because it's built around the weather, which is what we use temperature for the most. And the other thing that I don't like about Celsius is each degree is a larger amount of temperature. So they will tend to use a decimal place to specify, okay, it's 20.8 degrees, because that's different than 20.2. I like the Fahrenheit is the smaller increments, and so 70 degrees is enough. 71 is different enough from 70. We're never going to use the decimal.
I would never know the difference between 70 and 72.
Yeah, no, I agree with you, but if you look at weather channels in Europe or something, that you're going to see that they're going to put out an extra decimal for that, because a 1 degree centigrade is, I guess...
Because they have the measuring device to be able to get that specific. That's what I believe. I mean, as far as how it feels outside, I don't think you're going to know a difference. And to be honest, whenever you're talking about weather in Fahrenheit, what's the weather going to be? 80s? We give a wide range. We say low 80s or high 70s.
Yes.
So usually whenever we're going to be estimating or preparing, we know that it's going to be within a 5 degree range, because I don't think you're going to feel 5 degrees as well.
But okay, so in Celsius, they can't say it's going to be in the 20s, because that could either mean death.
Yeah. Okay. So, I mean, I like your idea of how it is more based on what we're going to be dealing with, but I don't know why you want to have two systems. That's where I come down with.
I just don't know why Celsius is better for the masses. Okay, if you're making measurements in a lab, fine. And I'm not saying there should be two systems. If it's better in the lab, then we should all adopt it. But I just think that Fahrenheit isn't necessarily inferior when we're talking about weather. When we're talking about what's on the stovetop, it doesn't matter what temperature water boils. And also the degree increment. If you go from 32 to 212, which is where water boils at Fahrenheit, that's 180 degrees difference, right? Is that what it is? Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's why it's almost double. 1 degree Celsius is basically 2 degrees Fahrenheit.
Yeah. Do you know what the difference between freezing and boiling in centigrade is?
100.
Yep, that's easy to remember.
I just don't know why you need to know that.
I don't have any basis for why we would keep Fahrenheit. That's my problem. Because it works better for us now, because we're used to it.
Yeah.
I don't think anyone in any centigrade country is going to feel that the system would be better to switch, just because this is what you're used to.
You're right.
But my main fight for a switch would just be for standardization, as always.
Yeah.
And yeah, there's going to be an adjustment period. But sticking with something just because it's the way it's always been is not the proper response. This is a huge undertaking if it would ever happen. And I actually do believe it will happen.
Yeah.
This is not based off of wishes and wants. It benefits industry. And if it is economically beneficial, that will push the advancement.
Yeah.
I think that we need to start changing our mentality behind the imperial system, and in my case, in the Fahrenheit system, and thinking that it is not superior in any way that is actually important.
You know, I'm not ready to leave the kitchen yet. I never really thought about it, but like, even the teaspoon and the tablespoon are imperial measurements, and I just take that for granted because it's like I have so many spoons and I know that one's big and one's little, and I don't have to, like, if you're going to force me to get into like, oh, this is 15 milliliters of baking powder, you're taking the fun out of it for me. I'm just like, oh, let me just grab a spoon.
Our measuring spoons are in the shape of butterflies, and it is horribly awkward to pour them. That was definitely an impulse by the wife, and it has been the bane of my baking existence ever since. It's just hard to judge whenever a butterfly fills up. I'm just saying.
Dude, I know what to get you for Christmas.
Thank you. Limited edition ground radio measuring spoons coming to the store soon.
That's right. And guess what? Imperial.
Only one of them is going to be metric. Just so you can't fit them all together nicely.
Yeah. You want to know my favorite measurement is, Z?
What's that?
When your wife's going to have a baby and they give you the fetus size over the course of her pregnancy with different fruits.
Yes. We found out she was pregnant whenever our daughter was the size of a blueberry. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah. I believe I was beginning to really grasp the importance when my baby in the womb was fig size. It really connected with me. I was like, oh, the size of a fig. How adorable. My little fig.
Yep, ours got to the size of a jackfruit before she made her appearance, and I've never known what a jackfruit was. I will say that that measurement made me more curious about food.
Yeah.
There was a lot of fruit that I just did not know about, and there were a couple times where there would be fruit where I disagreed that it was bigger than the last one.
Okay. You know, I think that different sites use different fruits too, but it did force you to kind of Google image some of the produce aisle. Well, I thought it was the most adorable scale that I had ever used.
Yeah, it made me think twice when I was eating strawberries. I don't know why, like it just made me feel kind of awkward. I don't know why we're using something that's edible, and now every time I'm thinking about it, I'm thinking of like my kid. But we used that, and I thought that was great. And it was relatable, but it wasn't accurate. It wasn't calibrated of any sort.
Mm-hmm. Certainly not.
But for everyday use, it was great. So that is a huge difference between whenever you're talking about daily use and scientific use and specific use, because whenever we are driving in our cars or if we have 100 yards for a football field, those things can be arbitrary. They don't need to be based off of anything, but you just know that if your vehicle is calibrated correctly and that sign says that you're supposed to be going the specific measurement, you're good to go.
Yeah, it's nice to be able to trust it. And the cops, when they pull me over, they are right, like, every time. When I'm like, my needle's probably a little bit off. No, their machine that measures it is right, and my dial that tells me how fast I'm going is right on.
The last thing that I would like to talk about is the need for things to be standard across the entire world. Within the United States, it's no big deal. If we want to use the standard system, that's fine. But whenever you start talking about dealing with the international trade or infrastructure, you need to worry about being consistent.
Yeah.
In the late 19th century, Russia was still using a Julian calendar. Western Europe was using the Gregorian calendar.
Is that a difference between 10 months and 12 months?
I thought the Julian calendar was just whatever day of the year it was.
Oh, the Julian doesn't incorporate the leap year and stuff. Yeah.
Correct. Containing yourself within your own country, it's not an issue. But when you start talking about trading between the two, that's when there were problems. They would have missed days on scheduling because they would be on two separate days of the calendar. Or more likely, the problem would be that the train tracks were actually different sizes.
Whoa.
So they were building locomotives that would only work on one set of tracks and they would not be able to cross over to the other set.
Wow. What a waste.
So that's where the standardization is important at.
Yeah, sure.
And now we're talking about most of our businesses international. We don't keep as much inside the borders as we want. To be a global player, you need to be on the same system as everyone else.
Mm-hmm.
So my vote is for globalizing the measurements.
Yeah, that was tragic. That was tragic for them. So they had to eventually, over time, they had to revamp their whole train system to accommodate.
Yes. And Russia changed their system to Western Europe because Western Europe was standardized metric Gregorian calendar. Calibration is really boring, but it's also super interesting that somewhere there is the pinnacle of precision, whether the National Institute of Standards and Technology has a exact measuring device.
Isn't it Weights and Measures?
Well, Weights and Measures, they are the department.
Yeah, you're right. It's not a national.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
But then the next level down, people will take their equipment and get it calibrated to that. And then the next level below them, they'll take their equipment and get it to the second level. So if you have a chain of calibration, you can actually follow it the whole way up to the national standard. And that's why it's important to get all your tools calibrated and to make sure that if you're calibrating it again, that tool is in calibration.
Yeah.
And they say right off the bat, there's no guarantee in perfection. The only thing they can do is minimize percentage of error.
Even after all that.
So to think that we use arbitrary distances, measure them to the best of our ability, and consistently try to produce equipment the exact size, there is a huge swing that we could be doing. So we're not even as precise as we like to think we are.
Yeah. I'd like to trust that in, you know, not people making tools, but the people, you know, measuring for experiments and to understand how the world works. Those guys, they...
More precise.
They gotta be. I'm telling you, those cops nail me every time. I'd love for just once for them to be like, no, that's not what my needle said.
And that's usually why they won't pull you for five over.
Uh-huh. Just to make up for that possible margin of error.
Mm-hmm. Because when's the last time you've been pulled over for just going a little over the speed limit?
Right. It'd be a waste of their time. All right. Well, that's all I got.
All right. We'll be posting this up on YouTube as normal. We will also be getting these pushed out to the podcast players through Google Play, Stitcher, iTunes. That will be down the road in a little bit, so not much longer of a wait.
Nice.
Please leave a review. If you want us to talk about something else, you can always do that as well. We are open. You can go follow us on Facebook. Send us a message there.
We have so many levels of becoming official.
Yeah, we're hitting different heights every day. Any feedback is always welcome.
Yes, please.
In the form of ones and fives. A 1-star or a 5-star only, because a 3-star is very weird and nobody takes the time to actually do that.
Mm-hmm. What we want is passion, regardless of the direction.
Yes.
Write in for any reason. Write in to argue with us. Write in to tell us we're awesome. Write in to tell us you're never going to listen to us again. That's fine, too.
So hit us up. Until next time, Paul, you have a good one.
Yes, sir. It's been a pleasure. And we'll talk soon.